Isn't that great when you read things like that? Well, let's go to evolution of the horse. Jonathan Sapati, PhD in physical chemistry, writes this. As the biologist Herbert Nielsen said, the family tree of the horse is beautiful and continuous only in the textbooks. And the famous paleontologist Niles Eldridge called the textbook picture lamentable in a classical case of paleontologic museology. In other words, here's the scientists, even the evolutionists, are saying this so-called evolution of the horse is only good in textbooks, but it is not what we observe in the fossil record. Here's another one. Out of the Houston Chronicle, 1980, science editor says, the popularly told example of horse evolution suggesting a gradual sequence of changes from four-toed, fox-sized creatures living nearly 50 million years ago to today's much larger one-toed horse has been known to be wrong. Transitional forms are unknown. So what do the facts support here? Well, today, we have living horses in a wide range of sizes. We have the English Shire about 6.5 feet tall, ponies under 5 feet, Farabella under 2 feet. In other words, we have small horses, medium horses, large horses. What are we showing in the fossil record? Small horses, medium horses, large horses. What's the difference? They're still living today. We have some horses today that actually have 3 toes. It's possible. They have that genetic capability. It's not very common, but it does happen. There's many different varieties of horses today that exist that resemble horses in the fossil record. And when we look at the fossil record, we see in these museums this arrangement, also in the textbooks, of small, medium to large. But is that the order we found them in? No, that is the arbitrary order they put them in the textbooks. It's the arbitrary order they line them up in the museums. When we go out to the fossil record, what we discover is these creatures, these horses that had 3 toes, 2 toes, and 1 toe, were all discovered at the same geologic levels in the fossil record. What does that say? They all lived at the same time. One did not evolve into the other. All that information is being kept out of our textbooks. So what do the facts support? The facts clearly support, once again, created after their kind. There are no factual intermediates leading up to the modern-day horse. So let's go to this one. This is a very popular one being taught today. Reptile to bird. Reptile to bird. And here's what a biology textbook has to say about that. To many paleontologists, a bird is a dinosaur with feathers. Now, wait a minute. I want to stop right there. I thought that the dinosaurs died out 65 million years ago, according to the evolutionists. Now they're teaching they didn't die out. They evolved into birds. Now, which story is it? Well, let's continue on here. To many paleontologists, a bird is a dinosaur with feathers. That definition may sound odd, but it makes sense. The first fossil ever found of an early bird-like animal is in the genus Archaeopteryx and dates from late in the Jurassic period, about 150 million years ago. Now, that is a great claim there. That is a great claim that a reptile with scales, completely different type of internal anatomy, can change into a bird. Now, in order to make that claim, they need to produce some real evidence. Well, let's take a look at another biology textbook here. Birds evolved from reptiles during the Jurassic period. So the textbooks seem to have a consensus that the dinosaurs, the small kind of dinosaurs, gradually evolved into birds and are living today. Is there any evidence to support this? Well, not according to some of the leading bird authorities. See, that one textbook said Archaeopteryx was an intermediate link. It's the intermediate link between reptile and birds. Half scales, half feathers. But here's what one of the leading bird authorities in the world has to say. Alan Fiducia. He says this about Archaeopteryx. Paleontologists have tried to turn Archaeopteryx into an earth-bound feathered dinosaur. But it is not. It is a bird, a perching bird. And no amount of paleobabble is going to change that. Don't you love these great scientific words, paleobabble? Because that is exactly what they're putting in our textbooks. Making a claim without being able to provide the physical evidence. Great claims require real evidence. We're being asked to believe somebody else's faith. Why should I believe evolution if they can't provide the evidence. I already have a faith. Why should I accept the faith of evolution? Now, why is Archaeopteryx called an intermediate link? Well, it had claws on its wings. Well, that doesn't really make it intermediate because we have birds living today that have claws on their wings, such as the ostrich, the Hotsin, South America. Well, it had teeth. Well, so do other bird fossils that we find. Pure bird fossils had teeth. Some reptiles have teeth, some don't. Some people have teeth and some don't. Are they evolving? So teeth are not a good idea of whether something's evolving or not. But you know, only birds have feathers. No other creature in this world has feathers, just birds. And Archaeopteryx had fully formed feathers. Here's what they have to say. Barbara Stahl, Vertebrate History, writes Problems in Evolution. The imprint they left in the rock, clear and sharp, makes it evident that the feathers of Archaeopteryx were already in Jurassic time exactly like those of birds flying today. How do you go from scales on a reptile to fully formed feathers on a bird? There has to be a mechanism to have that happen. Here's something more in Archaeopteryx. Remember that one textbook author made this statement. The first fossil ever found of an early bird-like animal is in the genus Archaeopteryx and dates from late in the Jurassic period, about 150 million years ago. What he's saying, this is the oldest intermediate link we found between reptile and bird. But wait a minute. Something's not right here. He's saying this is an intermediate link. But when we go to other sources, we read this. A fossil resembling a modern bird has been found in eastern Colorado in the same geologic strata as Archaeopteryx. Now, hold on, man. The textbook author said Archaeopteryx is an intermediate form. How can it be an intermediate form when we already have fully formed birds living at the same time? Why would it still be intermediate? It's not the oldest one. So the textbook author has not done his research. Then Texas Tech researchers have reported discovering birds and rocks dated much older than Archaeopteryx. Something is not right in our textbooks today. Either they're not doing their research, or they're deliberately not giving all the information. Now, let's think about this. Evolving from a reptile to a bird. The common idea is we've got to grow feathers. Well, hold on a moment. A whole lot more has to happen than that. See, birds and reptiles have complete different types of internal anatomy. There's more than just growing feathers. First of all, we do have to have development of feathers. We have to reform of the respiratory system, reform of the skeletal system, going to hollow bones for birds, reform of digestive system, reform of the nervous system, construction of bills and beaks, mastery of nest building, acquisition of flight, development of sound-producing organs, and many other things have to change. Even the whole heart has to change. The circulatory system is completely different between a bird and a reptile. In a reptile, they have a circulatory system much like what we do. The air comes in one set of pipes and goes back out the same set of pipes. But in a bird, it has more of what you call a real circulatory system. The air comes in and circulates all the way around like this and goes back out. How in the world does all those internal anatomy changes take place and that creature survive? There's no evidence this ever happened. The feather is a very complex organ. Very complex organ. We have a central shaft going down these feathers. Then we have these barbs coming out. Then off these barbs, we have all these barbules. And then we have these hooks on there. Now, these feathers, they slide back and forth like this. When that bird is moving, it slides back and forth. And when you have something sliding, it grinds on it and will gradually cause it to fade away or wither and fade and break. How does that bird keep this from happening? Well, it secretes a oily substance there to lubricate these feathers constantly. They don't talk about where that came from. Reptiles don't need that. Somewhere along the line, you've got to have this oily substance to keep those feathers from breaking apart through friction. Then just having feathers won't make a creature fly, won't make that bird fly. See, it's got to have primary feathers, but it also has to have secondary feathers to give it the lift. So it has to have all that. So how did all this happen? Well, here's the latest. I'm going to give you the latest explanation. This is what they're teaching in colleges. This is what they're teaching in some high schools, how a reptile evolved into a bird. Some of these smaller reptiles climbed up into the trees. This is the predominant theory now. They climbed up into the trees. They were jumping off these branches and trying to glide down. Well, wait a minute. How many of them went splat before they learned how to glide? And how many of them went splat before they grew feathers? And just growing primary feathers will not make that bird fly. It's got to have the secondary feathers to give it the lift. Well, maybe they evolved the feathers, but what's going to happen? It's still going to go splat. Why? Because their bones are too heavy. They've got to have hollow bones. So you've got to have the feathers, you've got to have the hollow bones, and you have to have all the other internal anatomy changes. All this has to happen. Where is the physical evidence all this happened?